Welcome back. It's Friday, and you know what that means. It's time for our Top 4 in 4 countdown, where I review the top 4 stories of the week in 4 minutes. These headlines consist of the news stories that everyone is talking about. Let's begin. Starting with headline number 4, the number of people staying in shelters after the massive flooding across South Louisiana continues to drop. The state estimated about 4,000 people remaining in shelters Thursday as more people found temporary housing with family and friends or returned to stay in their homes as they repaired them. At one point during the height of the flooding, shelters across several parishes housed an estimated 11,000 displaced by the storms. As the water continues to drain in most flooded areas, more than 85,000 people have registered for federal disaster aid with FEMA. Federal officials plan to speed federal disaster assistance to flood-stricken Louisiana. President Barack Obama has issued a disaster declaration for 20 parishes. Up next, headline number 3, the man killed in a police shooting that sparked 2 nights of violence in Milwaukee suffered from cognitive and mental health issues, and he carried a gun because he had been shot more than once in the past, that according to family members, that is. Seville Smith, 23, was shot and killed Saturday after a brief foot chase that followed a traffic stop. Police say Smith was fleeing, and officials have said the officer's body camera shows him being shot after he turned toward the officer with a gun in his hand. A few hours after the shooting, violence erupted on the city's largely black north side. Rocks were hurled at police and 6 businesses were burned. A lighter night of protests followed Sunday. Monday was calm, though 10 people were arrested. There were no reports of protesters gathering on Tuesday night. The black officer at the center of the fatal shooting that sparked nights of violence in Milwaukee attended grade school in the city, joined the police force as a teenage aide, and has lived near the shooting scene since at least 2012 and even knew the family of the victim. The city of 600,000 is the country's most segregated metropolitan area, surpassing larger, deeply divided cities such as Chicago, Cleveland, and Detroit in an analysis of census data found. Headline number 2 has to do with a little girl power. In a country where men's soccer is ingrained in people's psyche, women have found it difficult to find their place in sports because of the lack of athletic programs, funding shortfalls, and what they call unfair marketing decisions that promote men. But Brazilian female athletes are shining at the Rio Olympics, and people there are paying attention, some for the first time. But in the sports arena in Brazil, women aren't always celebrated or even encouraged to play. While boys could try out for dozens of under-17 clubs in soccer-mad Rio de Janeiro, there are only 2 places for girls to try out. Many school physical education classes teach boys soccer and girls volleyball. That practice dates back to 1965, when the military dictatorship in Brazil banned girls from playing soccer and other sports. But thanks to the strong performances of Brazilian women at the Rio Games, fans are shouting the names of women players at stadiums even when the men are playing. In the U.S., where women's soccer is much more popular, female players filed a complaint for wage discrimination earlier this year, contesting their male counterparts are paid much more even when women have outperformed them. Well, staying on the topic of the Olympics, the U.S. has done really well so far in the Summer Games. No lie, we've won 100 medals so far. But what does turn out to be a lie is the topic of headline number 1 in our countdown. According to the Associated Press, a Brazilian police official says American swimmer Ryan Lochte fabricated a story about being robbed at gunpoint in Rio de Janeiro. The official says that around 6 a.m. on Sunday, Lochte, along with fellow swimmers Jack Conger, Gunnar Bentz, and Jimmy Fagan, stopped at a gas station in a suburb of Rio where many Olympic venues are located. Well, one of the swimmers tried to open the door of an outside bathroom. It was locked. A few of the swimmers then pushed on the door and broke it. A security guard appeared and confronted them. The official said the guard was armed with a pistol, but he never took it out or pointed it at the swimmers. According to that same official, the gas station manager then arrived, using a customer to translate. The manager asked the swimmers to pay for the broken door. After a discussion, they did pay him an unknown amount of money and then left. The official says that swimmers Conger and Bentz, who were pulled off of a plane going back to the U.S. late Wednesday, told police that the robbery story had been fabricated. But what a crazy week. We talked about flooding and devastation in the Big Easy, unrest up north in Milwaukee, sports and Brazilian women, and also, to top it all off, a bogus robbery story. Well, did you notice? No politics in there? Yeah. Not talking about the buzz circulating around this year's election was unbelievably hard. little Trump impression there. I think he'd like it, right? Well, be sure to join me next week. I'll be counting down a new list of interesting stories and headlines that everyone is talking about. We'll be right back.